else, let us give over to you now.
Thank you very much, my sister, and thank you for the prayer and welcome everybody. And I trust that you have a beautiful morning. We've looked at seven steps, that's true. Seven ways of approaching Christ. Today we are, okay, in the five, seven, today we're going to deal with growing up into Christ. And then we're also going to look at work and the life. But remember, we've looked at the love of God, which basically runs through all this development, because the moment you miss that part, everything that happens is less than genuine. It is a fake. And then the sinner's need of Christ, then there's repentance, then there's confession, there's consecration. Then yesterday we spoke about accepting by faith that now that you have confessed your sins, that God has forgiven you. Like I said yesterday, sometimes we struggle to forgive ourselves. We struggle to accept that God has accepted us. And then the next one is discipleship. So the two, with acceptance by faith comes the peace, comes the realization, the experience of being forgiven. That internal peace, that restfulness. Jesus says, come unto me and I'll give you rest. And the greatest burden we carry is the burden of guilt, not just unemployment and sickness, but guilt. And when that is lifted off your shoulders, you feel that inward peace. You know that even though there may be challenges, you can sing the song, it is well with my soul. It is well with my soul. Though Satan may buffet, though the sea may roar, but it is well with my soul. Though I may be unemployed, it is well with my soul. Because that burden of guilt has been lifted from your shoulders. And of course, that's accepting by faith. You don't have to wait for feeling. God will supply the fact, and you move by faith. And the next one is discipleship. We're going to call it in the test of discipleship, which has to do with the character development, producing the fruit. So you have the Holy Spirit. So the fruit of the Holy Spirit and your character, that you now become a blessing. Now that you are resting, those around you may also find rest. Because remember, some of us, when we were not resting, we're not causing anyone around us to rest. Now that you've found your rest in Christ, now that you're leading a restful life, then your family, your children, your neighbors also find rest. If you used to chase them with a panga or a knobkiri, now they say, you know, ever since he has accepted Christ, now we can sleep in peace because you are in peace. People must not say rest in peace when you die. They say rest in peace to themselves, that now we are going to rest in peace because he is dead. But when you die in Christ, you're no longer that same person. Then everybody else may rest in peace. When you rest in peace spiritually, then everybody else around you physically may also rest in peace. So we made it very clear that in discipleship, the contrast is visible, that this is what this life used to be. This is what it is now. Of course, it may not be apparent at all times, because remember, not all of us were gangsters before we accepted Christ. Some of us have been going to church right through. We even say, I was born in the church, like in the vestry. So we have always been there singing. All you did was just to be baptized and you moved on and you became a Christian. But you will know the difference, that now I am walking with Christ. And even those around you who will notice that, yes, he was not a bad person, but he's just so great now. He's such a blessing. So the next steps, the following steps, will enhance even the ground we have traversed already by maintaining that, by developing that, by increasing that. So it becomes progressive. So that very peace now deepens. That very character continues to grow. So what you were 10 years ago when you accepted Christ, 10 years later, you are a better person. Remember, the closer you come to Christ, the more you see your faults, and that encourages you to even pray more. And I would argue and say, a person who has accepted Christ a year ago or a few months ago, and a person who's been walking with Christ for the last 40 years, there's the difference. And the difference is the one who's been walking with Christ for more than 40 years even prays more than the one who has just accepted Christ, because he sees his faults even clearer. I don't know how many of you would realize that when we were just accepted Christ, I don't know, maybe it's me, you could even do certain things that you can't do them now. You just feel like, I can't do that. So it's growth. You're growing to understand, to appreciate who Christ is. You would go to a shop, for example, and you pay with 10 rand and they give you change of 20 rand and you run and say, oh, God has given me, has blessed me. That's what you would do earlier on when you were still young in your journey. But now, as you've grown and you've developed and you know, you've come to appreciate who Christ is, that is no longer a blessing. You take that money back. So you see why it's important to underscore the fact that you are not saved by your growth. Because at what point are you going to be saved? You are saved by the fact that you have accepted Christ as your personal savior. And then the character of Christ stands in the place of your character. And then you develop, but you are not saved by growing. You're saved because you are born. Otherwise, growing is a process. At what point of that process will you be saved? That's the important part in realizing and experience the assurance of salvation. In Ephesians, Paul says, you were darkness, now you are light, walk in the light. That's all. The Bible is all about that, how to move from darkness to light and how light walks in the light. And when the Bible writes it, it will say, you were, but now you are no longer. That's how Paul would put it. So you address those who are in darkness to embrace the light, and then you address those in the light to walk in the light. And so the next steps now deal with the walking, it deals with the maintaining, sustaining this growth that has started. Remember, you're born and then move on, because there's nothing as ugly as a child who's born, beautiful as it is, but then it doesn't grow. I mean, spiritually, then you don't grow, you just sit there stunted and there's no development. So then it is up to, it makes sense and very relevant to look at the next steps. 8 and 9, growing up into Christ, and then work and the life. As I've mentioned already, the Bible depicts this repentance, sorry, and acceptance of Christ as growing up. We are looked upon, even though we be old, as new babies in Christ. The change of heart by which we become children of God is spoken of as birth. And the beautiful text which sums up this whole step, this whole chapter, is John 15, verse 4 and 5. Abide in me and I in you. So all that we do in our Christian journey is to learn to abide in Christ, to focus on Christ and not to focus on ourselves. And he continues to say, as the branch cannot bear fruit except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except you abide in me. Without me, you can do nothing. Even if it looks like something in your eyes, it is nothing in the eyes of God. It may still be worth it to those who are around you and may appreciate, but in the eyes of God, without him, you cannot be a Christian without Christ. So the whole process of growing in Christ is abiding, like a branch that stays on the tree and produces fruit. Of course, there'll be pruning here and again, there's the watering. All of that will enhance this growth. And we mentioned also that a life in Christ is a life of restfulness. You may not always be excited, but there's that internal joy. Yes, sometimes you have difficulties, but there's something in your heart that just, I don't know how you have, whether you, some of you have felt this. I know you have, you know, there are challenges, but there's something in your heart that just says everything is okay. Now it's like there's something that you are enjoying that is beautiful, but then you forget what it is, but it's there in your heart. You know, I'm fine. Yes, there are difficulties, but I'm fine. That feeling, that knowledge, that experience of knowing that yes, difficulties, but I'm okay. It is well with my soul. But what disturbs that peace, what disturbs that restfulness, and this is, we need to be very aware of that, alive to that fact. You see, when the mind dwells upon self, you are turned away from Christ, the source of strength and life. And that's the temptation, is to dwell upon yourself, is to measure your progress. Or let me see, how am I dealing with it? I mean, branches don't do that. You just abide in the branch. Just keep taking in that water. Keep drinking. Keep focusing on Christ, not on yourself. That's the shortest way of becoming despondent and discouraged. And she lists some of those things that would discourage us, that would make us lose our focus on Christ. She mentions the end steps to Christ in that chapter, growing up into Christ. Pleasures of this world would literally, at some point, if you continue focusing on the pleasures of this world, remove your eyes from Christ. Perplexities, like Demas, who fell in love with this world. It was not a once-off thing. He's been entertaining the world until he left and Christ. And that's what we do, going to church every day. We go to church every Sabbath, every Sunday. You are going to church, but you are also opening an avenue for the world to also have access into your heart. Before you realize you are out, you are no longer seeing value in walking with Christ. What about the life's cares, perplexities and sorrows? I'm unemployed. I am sick. I've lost this. And you focus on that. Whenever you come for prayer, you're praying for this. It's just only one negative thing. There's, you don't even see other beautiful things. We'll be talking about that when we look at rejoicing in Christ. The faults of others. You are so obsessed in looking at the fault of others. And not only their fault, even your own faults and imperfections. You feel like you're not supposed to be there. But remember what we said yesterday, that the closer you come to Christ, the more clearer you will see your faults. And that should not discourage you. It should actually show you that now you are getting closer. But the whole idea is you stop focusing on yourself. Don't turn away from Christ and look at yourself. Otherwise, you're turning away from the source and strength of your life. These things that the devil throws at us, all we need to do, bring all those to Christ. Let Christ deal with those and walk in freeness, in the freedom that Christ gives you. These things, even though they may look neutral, they may look harmless, they have got the potential to create unrest in our hearts. There is nothing as ugly as a Christian, a person who professes to love Christ, goes to churches, involved in evangelism, but is unhappy. There's no rest, there's no peace. As a result, he makes everybody else around, as I mentioned, very much unhappy. So we need to watch here. We need to watch, we need to strive, we need to pray that nothing may entice us to choose another master. For we are always free to do this. And the fact that you are walking with Christ doesn't mean you cannot stop. I mean, we know that Israel left Egypt on their way to Canaan, but going back to Egypt was always a possibility. And many of those died in the wilderness because their hearts were still in Egypt. And I'm going to say that again, just you left the life of sin and you're moving in the life of righteousness, towards righteousness and growing in holiness. You can always go back. Keep that in mind. That's why you have to watch. You've got to strive, you've got to pray, you can always go back. You are free. This is the beauty about being a Christian. You are free to go back. Look unto Jesus. You are safe. Nothing, the Bible says, can pluck you out of his hand. And Paul says, nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. It doesn't mean that you are not free to be separated. That's why we need to watch. We need to strive. We need to pray. If Christ is then if Christ is dwelling in our hearts, he will work in us both to will and to do according to his pleasure. That's Philippians 2, verse 13. And we shall work as he worked. We shall manifest the same spirit. And that's loving him and abiding in him. We shall grow, Ephesians 4, 15, grow up into all things, which is the head, even Christ. So now that's growing up into Christ, which takes up the whole book if you can observe. But then we look at the work and the life. So what happens? Now we are in Christ, we are resting. Is it a life of restfulness, a life of sleeping in Christ and not doing anything? Now, and here it starts in page 77, at least in my book, says, and wherever the life of God is in the hearts of men, it will flow out to others in love and blessing. There is nothing like, Lord, bless me for my sake. Lord, bless me so that I can be restful. The blessings that God gives to you, you become a conduit, and that those blessings flow out to others in love and blessings. You become not only loving, you become lovable. And that's basically saying that when Christ has touched your heart, you touch the hearts of others. You work and become a blessing to others. Love for Jesus will be manifested in the desire to work as worked for the blessing and the uplifting of humanity. It will lead to love, tenderness, and sympathy toward all the creatures of our Heavenly Father. And as you try to bless others, as you endeavor to bless others, that will react in blessings upon yourself. As you bless others, you become blessed. And in that process, then you grow. The only way to grow, she says, in grace is to be disinterestedly doing the very work which Christ has enjoined us to do, to engage to the extent of our talents and ability and spiritual gift in helping and blessing those who need the help we can give them. A Christian who does not exercise his God-given powers not only fails to grow up into Christ, as we saw in the previous chapter, but he loses the strength he already has. You lose even that which you have. In other words, you die if you don't grow. So it doesn't mean go to China and be a missionary. It doesn't mean be a pastor. There are pastors who are also miserable. They are pastors, but they're miserable. That restfulness is not there. So just being a pastor doesn't mean that's it. What it means is in the humblest duties of life, in the lowliest positions of life, there in the factory floor, in the executive, in the boards, in the higher echelons of life, you may walk and work with Jesus. By the way, 1 Corinthians 7, 24, beautiful text, it says, let every person wherein he is called, therein abide with God. Wherever, whether you are in parliament, whether you are in a factory that produces this, you are the CEO, but let Christ abide with you, abide with God. The businessman, she says, may conduct his business in a way that will glorify his master because of his fidelity. There's a forum for business here also, attached to 5 a.m. prayer. There's a forum for business, and the whole idea is not how to make more money. It is not just how to be wealthy, but how to represent Christ in the workplace. Like a statement in education, let me just divert a little bit. In the book Education, it says success in any line demands a definite aim. For you to succeed in any line, be it mechanic, be it business, be it teaching, be it preaching, if you want to succeed in any line, you must have a definite aim. And that aim, beloved, is for the giving of the gospel to the world. Once you focus and make that your aim, you will succeed in all other endeavors. What Christ does, you know, when for example, if you say, if you are married and your aim is to present Christ, your aim is to win others, your aim is to reach out to families with your husband and with your children, you want to be a blessing. Do you know what that does? It will make you, whenever there are challenges in your own marriage, you'll have enough strength to deal with those, because you are asking yourself, how are we going to witness to those around us if now we are in trouble? But if that is not part of your life, giving glory to God and letting people see who God is, things just go the way they go. If you are studying and you are representing Christ, you will make sure you pass, because you don't want people to think that God does not know maths. So you succeed in all lines that you are engaged in, because your focus, your aim, success is not the aim. But for you to succeed, you must have an aim. And that aim should be, I want God to be seen in my factory, in my business. And because you want God to be seen, then you do things, then you work hard, then you are creative, then you do this, because God must be seen. And in doing so, your work blossoms, your business blossoms, and becomes a blessing, not just for you to be wealthy, but it becomes a blessing to others. So as human workers cooperating with heavenly agencies, that education of rubbing shoulders with angels, it makes, actually, she says, there's no university course that can equal that. It rubs off. It makes you also enjoy and have an appetite for development. So it's not just spiritual development. The growth we're talking about, beloved, it's not just a spiritual growth in terms of Now I'm praying three times a day. Now I'm fasting. That's no, we're not talking about that growth only. Yes, that is part of the growth of getting closer to Christ. But the way you look at things, the way you think, the way you reflect, your creativity, your intellectual, your physical, all aspects. Remember, we're creating the image of God. We're not just spiritual beings. We are spirit beings, holistic. And all of that, as you engage, as you grow, that also grows. And I've seen people who never went to school, but because they are committed Christians and they can read and memorize the Bible amazingly. They may not be able to read other books, but when it comes to the Bible, they can memorize, they know the text, their mind is like a sponge. It's amazing. God does miracles with the little education you have. He grows you, he develops you, and you grow in all aspects. Everyone who names the name of Christ should so work that others, by seeing his good works, her good works, may be led to glorify their creator and redeemer. So they are workers with God in this life, and they are thus fitted for the higher work and the unshadowed joy of the life to come. I'm not going to get into that, but it would surprise others that this growth does not stop here. Even in heaven, we'll continue to grow. I mean, I just, because life would be boring. This is all I know, and nothing else. That understanding of the love of God will be our study and our focus throughout eternity, which means we will be growing throughout eternity. So the growth that has started here on earth will continue all the way. The joy that we have started will continue all the way. Every day with Jesus will be sweeter than the day before in terms of growth, in terms of understanding. When the Bible says you are holy, it doesn't mean you are static. It means there's nothing wrong with you. But in that holiness, even when Adam and Eve were created, they were not created just to be like zombies in a museum. They were to be holy, but then move on, grow. Not because they are in sin, grow in their understanding of God, eternal growth. Let it begin now. Let it start now. Let us pray together. Our kind and loving Father, thank you for this beautiful morning, Lord. And we consecrate everything. We surrender ourselves. We ask you, Lord, to guide us and lead us. And may you grant us that peace, Lord, that restfulness, that inward peace, that peace that passeth understanding in the midst of the challenges. May we express our joy, our gratitude, and thank you, Lord, for the life that you have given us. And as we move from hour to hour today, may we also create peace for those who are around us. Be a blessing in their lives as we work for you and represent you in the marketplace. And we have requests. Yes, that is true. We have issues that are troubling us. Those we'll present to you, but those have no right. They don't have the power to quench, the power to destroy that joy that you alone have given us. Bless us, Lord, as we now take time to reflect and to thank you and to pray and to talk to you. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen.